Morning, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started. This is going to be very impromptu, I've told most of you. Viola did not want any services. She made it very specific, and she said it over and over. But it reached a point where we really didn't have much of a choice. You know, people coming, family coming from Hawaii, you know, a couple of brothers that want to say their goodbyes. So anyway, you're stuck with me officiating. We're going to start off with a dear friend of ours singing Amazing Grace, Laura Cross. She has a voice like an angel. There's no power source out here, so she doesn't have her backup music. But I think you'll enjoy the a cappella version. So, Laura, if you'd be so good.
Well, here at this non-service, I guess love went out. And I maybe didn't get that wish, but I know she has a lot of other wishes that were met with her family here. So I'm going to pick a note. Amazing Grace for you. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Very nice.
You're welcome.
Very, very nice. I didn't mention that Laura, Sherry actually brought Laura over to sing for Tutu a time or two. And that's what she was known by, and welcome to the neighbors here. These are her neighborhood granddaughters. We used to take care of her and bring her her paper in the morning and kind of watched out for her, and thank you very much, and thank you for coming this morning. Bill or Bub, would one of you like to lead us in prayer right now?
Father God, we thank you again for the day or for the occasion that we have here in remembrance of our sister. We thank you for the knowledge of knowing her and with her. Daughter and his son. Pray that you might bless them in a mighty way. Be with each one of us who is gathered here this day, and may you bless each one according to your will. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Bill. At this point in time, I would like to share a little bit about Viola, and then in turn, any stories that you have are most welcome. When I first met my lovely wife over 30 years ago, she wanted to meet her mother. And the first time I met her mother, for those of you that remember the Central City Mall, down on the bottom floor, there was what, Taco Joe's, is that the name of it? Something like that. It was directly below the Merle Norman store. And so I met her and Sherry there for lunch, and you know, Sherry told me, you know, you've got to like my mom, you've got to love my mom. And so I did. And at the end of the lunch, you know, her mom said to me, just be good to her. And so I try to fulfill that. But nevertheless, I got stuck with Viola for many, many years. And she is a sweetheart of a lady. She had a country sense of humor. She could cook like you wouldn't believe for a country gal, one of her favorites. And I don't know, I think Sherry and Linda back there were privy to some of her meals a time or two, like the mashed potatoes and gravy and country fried chicken. She would make those for me. And on my birthday, every year she would make me what she called buffalo chips, which was a big cookie that had everything in it, you know, nuts, chocolate chips, peanut, you name it, it's in there, molasses, and it'd be done in a great big bowl, and sometimes I'd be there when she was making them, and she'd have to stir it. It was pretty tough to stir the dough. And every year she would do this, and some years she didn't have any walnuts, but she made them anyway. Another year, maybe she forgot to get chocolate chips, but she made them anyway. Anyway, every year on my birthday, I could count on a great big bag of chocolate or buffalo chips. And as years got, you know, went on, it became harder and harder for her to do. But she always thought of me. And she was a sweetheart. And we used to do everything we could to make her comfortable. So, you know, there's other stories I could tell, but I think, you know, some of you might have a few of your own. So if you have any that you would like to say, now is the time. How about some of you little gals there that used to come down and talk to her? Don't be shy.
I've got you shy girls now.
No?
Sue wants to hear.
Okay, Sue?
Yes, I met Lady, as I referred to her.
She talked to the crowd.
Not Viola Glee.
Oh, no.
She was Lady. In fact, when her brother-in-law came in asking for Old Glee, I thought, whoa, dude, hey, you know, I don't even know what you're talking about. And the Lady had a wonderful sense of humor, as Rick pointed out, and I met her when I came into Merle Norman. That's where I met Sherry, and she just had the ability to make everybody feel welcome and warm and comfortable, and we used to carry all these different fragrances, but your mom loved Jolly Sin.
Jolly Sin?
Jolly Sin.
That says
and
a lot.
And of course, very fitting, as we discovered. But she loved that. I swear she kept that company in business because she bought it, but she sold more of it than anybody else. No one else could sell this stuff because it just didn't fit anybody else. But it fit her. It fit her. It was her fragrance. It was her. Oh my gosh, yes, we had. She had attracted many various and sundry characters. Central City Mall, the thoroughfare down the middle was actually 3rd Street. So it was public thoroughfare. You could, you know, anybody could come in there and you can't run them out. They're just, that's it. They're on a public street. So we would get Hare Krishna, Scientologists, hookers, drunks. Yeah, we had them all. And she had this one guy who used to come in there and he always had his empty booze bottle with him. And he would jump over, we'd put this flower thing there trying to stop people from coming to the bath, didn't work. And he would just jump over it and, you know, it was like, hey, I'm here. And she also, one of my favorite memories of her was, because she was so good with people, she could talk to anybody and make everybody comfortable. This man came into the store and he was a very big burly man. And he had a mustache. And I mean, this was, you know, this was a big guy. And
what
he starts.
Year was this?
Oh.
70s?
In the 70s, okay. Yeah. Had to be before 79. Yeah, we're old. Don't
well, this is going
us.
Where I think it's going.
This is, yes, this is the one
might
where
it's important to know.
So this man came in and started asking questions about the products, and he wanted to know this and that. So she just, you know, talked away, chatter. And he kept coming back. But if it was Sherry and I were to be the ones there, he didn't want to talk to us. He only wanted to talk to ladies. So finally he confessed to her that he was actually thinking of going transgender. Now, this is not like Bruce Jenner being Caitlyn. This is Alex Karras becoming Alicia. I mean, he was a big guy with a mustache and a hairy chest and hairy arms and just, you know, burly. So she explained everything to him, matched him with a powder base. I could not believe it, but she did. Talking away, chatter. So we didn't see him for a while. He bought a bunch of stuff, but we never saw him for a while. And I thought, wow. Because apparently he confessed to her. His psychiatrist had told him that he needed to go away from where he lived and go ahead and transform into a woman, dress like a woman, and live like a woman, and see if this was really what he wanted. So he did, but we didn't see him for several weeks. And I thought, well, you know, maybe he just decided this wasn't for him. So one Saturday evening, just before closing, this guy walks in. We knew it was a guy, because it obviously wasn't a woman. With this kind of wig askew and this sort of shirt on, sort of a blouse, but you know, and this giant skirt. And so he comes in there and, you know, we're just like, oh my God, who is going to get stuck with him? So we're back there trying to decide who's going to wait on this guy, because none of us really want to talk to him. And so lady said, I'll go talk to him. So she walks out there and he smiles this big smile at her and he said, hi. And she says, hi. And he said, I bet you don't recognize me, do you? And then it dawned on her, this was Mr. Transgender. And she said, the understatement of all time, well, I didn't recognize you right off. Are you kidding? No one recognized. But we never saw him again, so we don't know what happened. But that's just, she could just deal with anybody. She was coming into her own after being a widow, and she was making her own identity, and she did a darn good job of it. She kept us in line. She was like my other mother. And after 40 years, it's just like losing my mom. So it's real hard. So anyway, I have fond memories, and they're always there for me. So, Sherry.
Thank you, Sue. Gentleman with the bald head by choice. Jack here in the black shirt. And lovely Cheryl standing next to the one in the back. These are Tutu's grandsons from Hawaii. And Kala and Cheryl, his wife, and Kalai, younger brother. And there's other kids, but they didn't make the trip. Anyway, they came over and, you know, again, Tutu didn't want any services or anything. They wouldn't hear of it. They came anyway. They are staying in Tutu's house, and they have been, how do I want to say, a godsend. They've helped us so much. And, you know, Cheryl is a workaholic, and they've, well, all of them have been working their tails off, and we truly appreciate it. You guys have anything you want to say? I mean, I remember these guys when I first met them, they were just little tykes. I used to pick them up sometimes, except for Claw. I think he was around 14 at the time. But if you guys have anything to say?
Yeah, Claw's going to do something.
Yeah, come up. All right. Keep it going.
Okay. Before you get up here, are you ready? You want to come up here or you want to stay there? Come on up. And don't be nervous.
We're among friends.
Okay. Well, my name's Crystal, and we're one of Tutu's neighbors. And we have so many memories of Tutu. We really love her, truly. And we just found out we call her Grandma. One of my best memories of Tutu, that she introduced us to Edie, and she was just so nice when we met her at first. When I found out that when she passed, it was really hard. But the best memory when she introduced us to Edie was that she was just so nice. She treated us like family, like we were her family. And we all knew we were already her family. So I'm really happy we got to get the chance to know people.
Your other grandma, too. She was the other grandmother. She was the grandkids, the close by grandkids that she. Because she would always laugh.
And she was going through on the first time.
She did.
That's true. She would sit in her throne, which today, afterwards, we're having something at the house. She would sit in her throne. That's what we call it. It's a lazy boy that's been used and abused. And she would view you guys growing up out the window. And she'd tell us blow by blow, blow what you guys are doing. What you're up to. You got a boyfriend or something? We don't. Well, that's nice. Is that it, or you got more? You have all the stories you want. You think? Are you sure? Thank you, sweetheart.
Right on.
Nice.
Right on.
I don't know how I'm going to follow that.
Well, you're not cute enough.
I know. So you can do the best you can. I'll try. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the eldest grandson, Edward Kala Hoanoko Poihemolele, who's named after both grandfathers, and I'm referred to as Kala. My wife Cheryl, my little brother Kala'i. First off, thank you for all coming, because I know this was very unexpected, and I know Tutu, really this is more than what she ever wanted, but I think she knew. She knew that there would be somebody here for her, but she was the type that really didn't want to inconvenience anyone. She was just so humble. So when I heard about her wishes, I said, I don't care, we're coming. We're coming. So, but I really can't dig up a lot of stories. But the most recent one was I found the guitar. Turned out to be our grandfather from Hawaii. And I vaguely remember when Tutu used to, when she could travel, always come to the islands on a regular basis. But I just recently found out, because I know Uncle Rick's all into guitars and everything, and then Tutu just told me a story how my mom's dad always used to serenade her, and I'd like to share that song with you. And if I knew about this earlier, I would have took guitar lessons from you and directly. I'm known as the electronic guy, but I'm kind of losing it right now, so. Unfortunately, he came for a session like this, but unfortunately, a lot of times, that's the only time we get together, is something like this. With that said, I hope to see you guys at Tutu's house, and if you didn't know, Tutu means grandmother in Hawaiian, so that's why we call her Tutu. And thank you all for coming.
That was beautiful, pal.
Can't remember.
You got your beep beep on? You're gonna reverse or?
Yeah, I'm gonna try center.
Here, you wanna? Let me move
all
this.
Right,
let
all
me
right.
Move
he,
this.
He's just gonna.
Oh, right, okay. Okay.
Okay. Front of stable.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
Right.
I don't know if I can do it or not. Anyhow, this one's a little older than me. And I, of course, my name is James Arthur, but she named me Bub, and the reason she called me, I was called Bub. Everybody that knew me back in Missouri, and even all the family, I was Bub. And the reason for that is she couldn't say brother, she said Bubber. But Seth and I grew up together. A lot of fun, a lot of fond memories, but she was a good old girl, I'll tell you. Walked to school together, and we washed the dishes and dried the dishes together on the old home place and done the chores together, and I'll miss her. But she's in a better place now, and she's at rest. She's not hurting. And like I say, she was a good old girl. One of the things that she couldn't be, find something to laugh about, but like I say, we grew up together in some pretty hard times. She was about three years older than I am, I guess. I'll be 86 to 27. So that made her, she'd be 89. Well, we grew up on the old home place, built and remember it. We didn't have anything.
Of course, our dad died. I was only 3 and a half when Daddy died, so I very vaguely remember him. But Seth was there, and like I say, we didn't have a whole lot to eat, but we survived, and it was a good experience for us. And sometimes we wouldn't have much to eat for supper, and Mother, God rest her soul, she's buried here somewhere. She made sure we had a full belly to go to bed on, even if just mice, but that's right, it was filling. But Sis and I done a lot together, I'll tell you. And like I say, I'll miss her, but she's in better hands now, and she's resting now. She's not suffering. So, like I say, if she's a pretty good old girl, all those that knew her, like these little people who live next door to her, called her Tutu. Well, like I say, she was just out of way. She never seen a stranger. But she was a pretty good old girl, but that's about all I got to say.
JR would like to say something.
I made it.
Good job, Bub. I always wondered why you were called Bub. Now I know.
That's the reason.
Well,
it's the same reason she was called Sis.
Yep,
yeah,
Sis.
And I always called her Aunt Sissy.
Yeah.
Well, so she was always my Aunt
Sissy.
Aunt Sissy.
Yeah. Yep. How can I put it? She was quite a character in so many ways. I don't know where to start. Because calling her on the phone, I can hear her answering the phone right now. She had her unique answer. Going over and visiting with her, she'd be in her throne.
Work her crossword puzzles.
Oh yeah, she'd have her crossword puzzles there. So we'd sit on the couch and, hey, what's going on? And we'd get an update on everything that was going on. Everything about what's going on in Hawaii and all the kids and grandkids. Sherry, she'd always give updates on you. And so it was a lot of fun. She had a very unique sense of humor. Would you call it a dry sense of humor? Yeah, sort of half and half.
That was the Irish coming out in her.
Yeah, well, Irish?
She's part Irish. We all are. Yeah. Well, got a little Irish in her. You got a little bit in your blood. Scott, Irish, Dutch, and Welsh.
Yeah. Which part,
Well, that explains a lot.
We lean to the Irish.
Yeah. I don't
know. Our
we
sense
could
of humor.
Just divide you in thirds. Third this or that.
Yep. It just sort of moves around, huh?
Yep.
So, yeah,
everything Patrick's Day, we all turn green.
Is that it? So yeah, she was quite a character, and I can remember going by her house when I worked at Sage's and going by and visiting with her. What street was that on? Carter. No.
Carter Street between Joyce and Sage.
Yeah. And she was just always a good down-home person, and I know that she. Well, let's back up. Her and Shirley's mom were like peas in a pod. Biscuits and gravy.
Yeah.
Or I don't know how you want to say it. But they definitely liked each other. And I think they had the same sort of weird
sense of
humor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're up there laughing.
That's why I got along with her.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, it helps, doesn't it?
It
really does. So yeah, I'm gonna miss her. I'm gonna. But in all the times I go over and visit, you need to go away. I'd ask, is there anything I could do to help or whatever? And usually Rick had already been there, or he was on call to go do whatever. But I'd see that car sitting in a garage. And so what are you going to do with that cougar, besides fold your laundry on it or whatever you do out there? And I don't know. I go, if you want to get rid of it, I'll take it and I'll restore it. And And I won't soup it up or anything. I'll just put it all back to stock. And so the last time I got to visit with her, because she wanted to see the car after I got it finished. And so Dad and I went over, and she came out and checked out the car. She was so happy to see that car all. And the day that the auto club came over and picked it up, because it hadn't been run for so long, so I didn't want to take a chance on starting it. So they came out and picked it up, and yeah, she had a lot of memories leaving in that car. And I can't imagine her getting in and out of that car, because I got enough trouble getting in and out of it, because it's set so low. So anyway, Aunt Sissy, it's all restored. You've seen it. So I hope you're proud of it. I tell everybody now that I put my Cougar in the Cougar and we go cruising. So anyway, I got a lot of good memories of your mom, Sherry, and she was very, she was great.
I have a lot of memories as well, the four of us.
Oh yeah, back Sherry on the farm, and you guys used to come over and spend time with us on the farm, and
oh, yeah.
We used to go into town and spend time with you guys.
Yeah. You were the troublemaker.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, I'll miss her. She was great.
Thank you, J.R.
You're welcome.
Bill?
I better not get started.
Better not? Yeah, okay. We'll just leave the rain barrel memory to our imagination. Anyway, you know, one thing about Viola is that, you know, she didn't want to be a bother to us, and we would lecture her, and Sherry would have very stern conversations with her that you are not bothering us, you know, please call. If we don't know, we can't help. Don't let things pile up and give it to us, you know, tell us about it when it's an emergency. Just let us know as things happen. So what happens is one night I get a call around, oh, I don't know, 10:30 at night, and it's Mom, and she says, I don't know what's happened. The hallway is filled with water. And I'm, what? Huh? What? And, and I'm half asleep, and so I jump up, and I throw together some water, or, you know, monkey wrenches, tools of various sort, whatever I can come up with in that diminished capacity that I was in mentally at the point. I get over to the house, I rush over there, and then she says, oh, I found what it was. I left the water on in the back bedroom, you know, in her bedroom bathroom. And I said, what? I left the water on.
Did she
on.
Need to plug in the sink? In the sink?
Yeah. Well, no, she didn't. It was a wash rag.
Oh,
and,
yeah,
and
all
she
right,
left
yeah.
it running and went off and it overflowed.
But she got to remember, Rick, when she grew up, we didn't have indoor plumbing.
Well, I didn't hold it against, we didn't have indoor plumbing,
but we had running water. A lesson, you grabbed a bucket, you run out the well and fill the pool, and you run back in the house. And we did have running water.
Yeah,
now, that's why she had that running water. What if she didn't have the well?
Is that where the rim shot comes in, Uncle Rick?
Yeah. Anyway, that's an inside joke about the dog we had. Anyway, so she told me, she says, yeah, I left the water on. And I said, oh, how long have you been running? Since 1 o'clock today. That's when I was last back there. She hadn't been back there since.
Yeah, the floor needed scrubbing anyhow.
Yeah, well, it did. And that's when we first figured out that she needed hearing aids because she couldn't hear it running.
Yeah, right.
She could not hear it running. So anyway, you know, I talked to Sherry and I said, don't be mad at her. But we had to rip up all the carpet and do a lot of work there. So it was fun, but no, God love her. You know, we had so many memories of her. Does anybody else have anything that they would like to say?
No. I just want to say that we moved into the neighborhood approximately 20 years ago, this May. And when we met her, first time we met her, she right away made us feel family. My grandkids were her grandkids. So we were her kids too. That's the type of person she was. She was loving, caring, humble, and she made you feel. You could feel it right away. She did. You were not a stranger to her. She shared a lot of love. She had a lot of love. She was a very loving person. And we loved her. We loved her very much.
She never had much, but she wasn't afraid to give you what she had.
No, she wasn't. Even if it was just a kind word.
Yes.
Or comfort.
Yes.
Comforting word. She was there. And it didn't need to be material. It just needed to be from her heart. She was a very loving person. And that's how we'll always remember her as a part of our family. Always be a part of our family.
I'm glad for her. I'm glad for you.
She was always, she'll always be a part of it.
Good.
Well, we're going to have something back at the house.
One more, Cheryl.
Oh, I'm sorry,
no,
Cheryl.
No, I didn't see you stand over. Come on up. Okay. No, I'm Cheryl, the other Cheryl, because she's also a Cheryl. But I had
That's
to pick
a
husband.
Cheryl because you love me so much.
But I first, I'm not sure if Auntie Sherry remembers this, but I first met Tutu and Auntie Sherry, and my husband was working in Orange County, and I think we ate at a Sizzler's. And she drove in our rental car, brand new rental car, and she was really amazed by the fact that there was lights on the locking mechanism and the window that would go up and down. She said, the cars can do this now? I would like to upgrade my car. But, you know, she was, and every Christmas or birthday, you know, she would send these little comic strips, and she'd cut it out and we'd all read it and everything. She'd say, well, did you get that? I said, yes, we got it. And coupons. She loved to send me coupons. The envelope was really thick of coupons. And she said, I think you could use this since you have 3 kids. So, you know, but what is ironic now is our oldest, who is now 23, she loves to coupon. So when she was able to come here in May, and I told her, you know, you should talk to Tutu because she's a professional. She was couponing before, you know, coupon was even in. So I'm pretty sure her and Tutu got to talk about it. So that's one of the fondest. You know, unfortunately, our children couldn't come, but they, you know, I told them just have nice memories of her. And, oh, every year we'd come. She had pots and pans that were really old, so especially the frying pan, and we always did this, or she was always upset. We'd buy new ones, we'd get rid of the old ones, and we wouldn't tell her until, you know, we got home. And she would talk to me, and she said, you did it again! Which pan did you throw away? So, yeah, we always did things to her, and she, you know, she would get upset, but she was very thankful for it. So. And girls, thank you very much for, you know, keeping an eye on her. Our youngest, Dee Dee, she's the one that told them about Tutu. And actually, Tutu's the one that said, you know, go outside and make friends with them, because those girls were very little when we first met them. So, you know, we've actually been, he says 7 years, but we've been coming here since like 94. So. So they were babies. All the girls in the neighborhood were babies, and mine was a baby too. So they've kept in contact throughout the years through Tutu, and Tutu always tells them, you know, oh, I saw Gracie and Crystal, you know, or there they are riding up and down my, you know, driveway, and they get her mail. So she was really grateful for you guys. Thank you.
Everybody's more than welcome that she had. It's covered and it has her picture on it. And nobody's going to sit there today. So sit someplace else. But you're welcome to any seat in the house.
Uncle Rick, Clay wants to play a traditional farewell Hawaiian song.
Oh,
okay.
All done.
Okay.
So that you know.
Does anybody want to give a closing prayer and we'll close with the song?
Uncle. Heavenly Father, we're gathered here together to remember this loved one. We'll miss her, but we know she's in good hands. She's in your hands now, so. And someday we hope to see her. And like I said, we appreciate the people who came out to remember sis. And we thank them for their lives and watch over them too. And take care of them. We'll give you the credit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The song is Aloha Oi. It means pretty much goodbye until we meet again.
I want to get you doing it.
Okay, what's it mean?
It's Aloha Oi, the name of the song. It means goodbye until we meet again.
You and Kala are killing us with the songs. You're breaking my heart.
Unfortunately, my brother never got the opportunity to travel like I did. So it's awesome that he could show up for this. And like I said, even Tutu's gone, but Auntie Sherry's here, and Uncle Bob, Uncle Bill, still family. You know, we got all our differences, but not all family's perfect. But when it counts, that's when you make it happen. And again, I thank the neighborhood girls for letting Tutu be a grandmother, you know, in our lack of being there. So thank you very much. Thank you very much. She was a big hugger, and you know that, right? So thank you for filling in for us while we were so far away.
Right. You haven't been in the video at all, you've been doing it all.
So I know it'd be a miss, that's why.
Thank you all so much for coming as we release Viola to God. Thank you. Hope to see you all back at the house.